Taurus by the Horns podcast.
By the Horns.
The Taurus by the Horns podcast with national and world champion pistol shooters Jesse Harrison and KC Eusebio starts now.
Welcome back to this month's episode of Taurus by the Horns. We're your hosts, Jesse and KC, and we're extremely excited to announce that we are now on video. So if you're only listening, head over to taurususa.com and find the video so you can now watch us as we interview our friends. Cool. So a couple of months ago, our CEO sent Casey and I this video of an incredible experience of a brother and sister out on a bear hunt that very quickly turned into a survival situation.
Yeah.
And they just so happened to be carrying the Taurus Raging Hunter and 454 Casull.
That is awesome.
And of course, we've got that bad boy that just saved our lives. We're right by it, quick access in case we need her again.
And as soon as we saw this video, we're like, we have to get these guys into the factory. We have to hear their story. And here we are today with Tana Grenda and her brother, Trevor Schneider. Big guy on this, guys. Thank you so much for being here. I know you flew a long way to get here from Alaska and Idaho, and we're very excited to have y'all here. Y'all are our guinea pigs for how this whole video thing is going to work out. So, all right, guys, why don't we just jump into, tell us a little bit about yourselves before we hear, like, the meat of the story. We'll start with you, Tana.
Yeah, so my name's Tana Grenda. I live in Alaska now in a town called King Salmon. And I grew up in Idaho with my brothers. I've got three brothers, and I'm the only girl, lucky me. So I kind of...
Are you the youngest?
No, middle. He's the youngest.
Nice. Okay.
I'm 3 years older than him, and I just kind of learned to be like one of the boys. And so they took me out hunting and fishing and lived in the outdoors, and that was my whole upbringing. So as I left school, you know, you kind of have to find your identity of, do I still want to be this person, or what do I want to do with my life? And I kind of found aviation, and then I ended up moving to Alaska and just ran with hunting because I loved it so much. And so, I met my husband, moved to Alaska, and now I live up there with my husband and 5 kids. And we just, our whole life revolves around hunting and adventure and flying. And I mean, I miss Idaho, but I'll probably never go back. But all my family lives in Idaho, so things like this actually bring us together. I haven't seen Trevor since his wedding last year, so.
Oh, awesome.
Congratulations, by the way. Recently married.
Yeah. A couple months.
And so I work in Alaska. We live pretty remotely off the road system. And so I started an online business where I could help people from all over the world get in shape and get fit and get healthy. And so I do a lot of coaching, nutrition, and fitness stuff. And then I started hosting women's retreats after the bear hunt, actually. It kind of sparked this interest and idea in me that, you know, if I wasn't prepared and trained for this kind of survival scenario, I wouldn't have lived. And so that prompted me to do retreats in the bush and, like, take women out that love to be outside and love to hunt and stuff and show them how to be safe and, you know, how to carry sidearms and how to survive when stuff hits the fan. So
field dressing as well.
Yeah, where we had to skin rabbits and we do shooting. And so it's just kind of an all-encompassing experience. And that's been so much fun. This is my second year doing it. But
and that's
where I take women from all over the world. Bristol Bay Retreats, right?
Yep.
Okay, so my coaching business is Bristol Bay Fitness. My retreats is Bristol Bay Retreats. And so I bring women from all over the world. I even have a gal from Australia this year. I'm really excited.
Oh.
And just take them out, fly them out in the bush and say, all right, let's survive for a few days. And we train them on everything. And then we have a lot of fun, too.
How does that go? Like, are the women fully prepared for what they're going to go through? Or are some of them just coming in blind and have no idea what to expect?
No, I mean, most haven't ever visited Alaska before. And so they're being thrown into the elements and the weather.
Yeah.
And what it's like to be completely disconnected from the world in cell service. And you're just dropped in the middle of nowhere. And we have some beginners, you know, like last year I had a couple that had never even camped before.
Oh, wow.
It was a mom and her daughter. And they didn't tell me that until they got there. And then they're like, yeah, this is our first camping trip. I said, wow. Really? So we are going out to the middle of nowhere and you're going to learn everything you need to know. So my thing is, if you can survive a week with me in the bush, you can survive anything.
Nice.
And that's kind of how my retreats were born, actually, is from this experience.
So if Jesse goes up there, Yep. I can go and I can hang out with Adam, right?
Okay.
I can hang with Adam.
You can't hang with the girls.
Okay.
Absolutely. That's awesome. Girls only for
now. Yeah.
Nice.
That's awesome.
What about you, Trevor?
Yeah, so my life's not quite as interesting as Sam's. I'm pretty much just a realtor in North Idaho, and I try to make money so that I can have fun, so which is mainly hunting and snowmobiling. And so I try to get up to Alaska every possible opportunity that Tana and Adam allow me. They're kind of my go-to for up there, just because the airplane and everything else like that. So, and then, of course, for certain animals, they have to be my next of kin. So that's pretty much.
You're like downplaying yourself. I watched a video of you and Adam shooting tall sheep together. You're like, that's pretty epic.
Yeah, no, yeah, I do try
to.
It's not a big deal.
I'm out.
Well, and me and Adam are both scared of heights, so yeah, that was a pretty tough one for me to do. But I like it. I mean, it's an interesting thing for me because I always like mountain animals, but then I'm scared of heights. So it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. I'm like, oh, the sheep is what I want to get or the mountain goat. But then, once I get on top of the cliff.
Sea level sheep, I'd be down to
that. We actually did a goat hunt from sea level up 2 years ago.
Really?
Yeah.
Where's that at?
Where?
Up in Alaska.
Alaska.
Yep.
Then you guys also do Stuck in the Rut.
Yes, we do. Yeah. Yep. And so, that's kind of our main thing that we do. I try to just get as many videos and stuff of our hunts as we can with Stuck in the Rut. And we even do some shed hunting and stuff, but mainly just try to focus on real hunting videos.
And that's kind of just a little family run thing that y'all do, right? It's you two and your husband Adam and your other brother. Is that correct?
Yep. We have two other brothers, us two, and then we added Adam to the Stuck in the Rut crew.
He brings a lot to the table.
Oh, yeah.
He does. Yeah, he does. With an airplane and all that stuff. And he's pretty cool with me, I guess.
Yeah, our older brother started Stuck in the Rut in 2010.
Oh, wow. Like
13 years ago, because he was seeing all these hunts on the Hunting Channel and everything was, professional film. And he just wanted to put out, the real raw footage. Yeah. We go on a hunt. We kill this animal. This is how we do it. And we do it all do-it-yourself, no guided things. And so he started just self-filming hunts, and then I was pretty young then, and so was he. And so then as we grew up, he started filming us, and then we kind of took turns and just filmed each other. And, it's still not professional film, but we just self-film, self-edit, and put it out as a hobby, and it's grown over the last 13 years. We have a pretty big following and people that watch our videos. We don't make any money from it, but it's fun.
We're educating everybody.
It's
huge entertainment. On YouTube at 10 at night, I'm watching hunting videos, and your guys' stuff pops up quite a bit, and I love it. People don't understand how hard it is to actually film a hunt. It's not like, all right, it's gonna be perfect. Make sure that I'm gonna shoot it, and then you'll be filming. Like sometimes the camera angles aren't right.
To be honest, we had 2-3 years of missed the shot. And my brother, you'd have it and just get chewed out by my brother. It's just like, oh, sorry, we missed the shot. And he'd yell, I just get yelled at for a while for it. And it's just a learning process, And so it took a couple years, and cameras have gotten better. And with GoPros and stuff like that, some of that's changed.
Yeah.
But it's still difficult getting the footage and getting everything on camera and good film of it.
But I love the organic value of y'all's videos. There's no post shots recreates, let's recreate that, make it look better. Like, it's
real.
What's happening in the moment, and that's it.
Yep.
And I think I like that aspect of watching a hunting video as opposed to one that you can tell has just been recreated.
Whispering.
I appreciate that aspect of y'all's videos. So for anyone listening or watching, you can go to YouTube and look up Stuck, letter N, The Rut, and you can find these guys. You can see all of their hunting stories. You can see the bear attack video that we're about to jump into and get all the nitty-gritty details. Head over, check them out, and why don't we get to it? So Casey and I are just going to sit here and absorb all of this. We watched the video, and I'm getting goosebumps thinking about it. But we're going to try and be as quiet as possible. I'm going to have a lot of reactions. But y'all take it away. Tell us, I want to hear every detail of this story.
So, it kind of all starts with my brother-in-law, Adam, which is Tana's husband. Mm-hmm. And so he is usually kind of the logistics guy for everything up there. So he found us a spot that he thought would be a good spot for us to go. He flew Tana out, and he coordinated to have a buddy fly me out, which on top of it, I mean, it's that's always an element in Alaska is the fly-out portion of it. Because, we were flying coastal with a very low ceiling. I mean, just flying along above the ocean. I mean, it's just cliffs straight out of the ocean. And it's like, if you have an engine failure there, it's bad news. But
there's no room for...
Yeah, there's not really anywhere that you could get out of it. But yeah, we're always thankful that Adam's the best pilot that I've ever seen. And so he always can get us in good spots. And he went and landed us down on the beach and we started to get camp set up.
Wow. The real question is, do we have enough stuff? Got snowshoes, got clothes, bows, guns, everything you can imagine. We've got it.
We made
it. Like a walking Cabela's right here.
So cool.
Yeah. So... it's kind of funny because there were so many things that like led up to this experience. And one of them was the crazy weather we flew in, like Trevor said. So we land on the beach and Adam drops us off along with his buddy. And as soon as they take off, like I have the camera rolling and I want to get Trevor's reaction of like his first, you know, the plane flies away and you're stuck and you're like, you realize you're just here by yourself. Like, this is it, you know? And Trevor turns around and he sees the video and he's like, I feel like we're going to die out here.
All alone.
Feels like I'm gonna die out here.
We were laughing, you know, because we joke a lot. We were best friends growing up, the siblings, and so it was just like it's pretty eerie between the weather and, you know, it was just really crummy going into that hunt, and it's kind of spooky.
And
looking back on it,
And I specifically can't say why I said that because I mean I've been on plenty of Alaska remote hunts before that. They were dropped off on an airplane and it was just me and her, or just me. And yeah, I mean, so I don't know why specifically that day I just had that felt feeling. It was just, we kind of already were starting to feel it.
So for this type of hunt, what are y'all packing out? What are you taking with you? How long are you planning to be out there?
This was initially planned for 14 days. We were planning to do 2 weeks. Yep, 2 weeks. As max amount of time, hopefully it doesn't take that long. And to be honest, Tana, after about 4 days, she's like, there's something wrong if we haven't killed something yet. She starts to get a little bit anxious if we don't have
six kids at home, so it's hard for me to be away for 2 weeks. This was my third brown bear hunt. 2 years prior, I'd shot a brown bear with my bow at 50 yards.
What a badass.
And then the next year, I took my 12-year-old daughter out, and she shot a brown bear.
Whoa.
And I was her, like, backup, you know? And so to me, like, oh, this is just easy. And Trevor wanted to do an archery, so we brought his bow, and then we had a backup rifle, and then the backup revolver. And those are the three weapons that we had. And he's like, I think we have enough stuff. And so we pack everything, you know? We pack food, and we get water there, so we filter it all, but... we want to make sure that we're prepared for worst case scenario, you know, really cold weather. It's like the 30s there and there's snow still up in the mountains and it can blow, you know, 30 to 60 miles an hour and get really, really cold. So we've got layers, you know, out to like puffies and rain gear and you've got a couple pairs of boots and you have everything you need to survive out there for 2 weeks.
Yeah. And I mean, just an example to tell you how the weather is, we had 2 days once we got there that we were weathered in the tent. And so Tana went out.
Don't even leave.
Yeah, Tana went out, or me and Tana went out with our rain gear on to get water, because we had to get water. Mm-hmm. And Tana with fresh, dry, Helly Hansen, thick rubber rain gear, she was soaked through in about a half hour of getting water. And so it was just downpour for 2 days straight and fog. And so you're just stuck in the tent that whole time.
You don't want to go to that because you get hypothermia and then you create an emergency that doesn't need to happen. And so, you tent it out if it's bad weather. And then when it's decent, you go.
Yeah. Was that like the first few days y'all were there?
It was. Yep. Luckily, we got there a couple days before season. And obviously, we needed the good weather for Adam to fly us in, or good enough weather. The next couple days weren't good enough to fly. So he was basically trying to get us in before a storm.
Yep.
And then we had a couple days to wait.
Okay.
And then I think the first day of season actually was a nice day. We got the sunny day for the first.
Oh, that was pleasant.
Yeah.
With bear hunting, you want a glass. So you don't want to spread your scent around and move around a bunch. So we kind of land on the beach, pick a camping spot close to a knob that we can sit up on and we can have as much of a vantage point as possible all the way around with the 360 view. And that gives you enough chance to just glass for 16 to 20 hours a day. I think it's more like 20 hours of daylight at that time of year.
Yeah.
Because it's doesn't get dark till midnight, and then it's light at like 4 or 5 a.m.
Oh, my gosh.
So you are just on the glass for hours and hours and hours. And so that's what we did the first day, I think, was just, well, the first couple days is glass and see where the bears are. And there wasn't hardly anything. We were starting to get pretty discouraged. Like, where are all the bears at? But we had a winter.
Yeah, I think that kind of led up to the situation that we put ourselves in, was just the lack of bears that were out of their dens that time of year.
Usually they're on the beach and they'll come down and eat the seaweed and dig clams and stuff. And there were no bear tracks on the beach. The only tracks we saw were way up in the snow, up in the cliffs. And grass wasn't green down low yet because we had a late winter. So it was just kind of one of those, oh, this can be a hard hunt. Like, we're really going to have to hike into the snow to even find a bear.
Gosh.
Yeah.
So at what point, like how many days in are y'all glassing and out there until you spot
a bear or a bear? I think it was the second day of season that we woke up. We got to the knob right at first light, and we hadn't even eaten our breakfast yet. And I pulled out the spotter, and I spotted a bear a couple miles away, right above us, like on top of this ridge. And I'm like, it looks like a shooter. And Trevor looked at it, and I don't think I had eaten anything, but we're like, we just gotta go, because he was going out of sight. And we went after that bear that morning. That was a nice day. It was like, we were in t-shirts. I think I even took my shirt off at one point. And I was like in a sports bra. It was like 60 degrees and sunny and hot. Wow. Oh.
The wind kind of keeps swirling, so hopefully it doesn't wind us, but we get up on the top of this ridge, see if we can glass down where we saw him this morning, and hopefully we can kind of make a play on him or see him. But
and that was a beautiful day, but we got up into like this beautiful snow basin,
mm-hmm.
and that bear.
It is,
but it winded us. So we put a stock on it, but it winded us. And
how far away?
It was trying to go up through a notch on a mountain, and so we had it at about 1,000 yards. But then we were trying to cut it off, and so we went all the way around the mountain to the notch. And of course, right before we got to the notch, the wind switched, and he was just about up to the notch when we last saw him, and there was no tracks coming up and over. And yeah, you could just tell that's what happened. Mm-hmm. And we went back around, and you could see his running tracks running up in the snow the other direction. And so, yeah, he just caught our wind.
Kind of deflating.
Oh, yeah. It was one of those like, oh, that bear doesn't look too far away. It took us 6 hours to get up there.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
And then we got up there. We're like, wow, that took a really long time to go 2 miles.
Yeah.
He only knows that far away. Alders.
Yeah, and I think it was further than that. It's just that kind of terrain that's very deceiving.
Yeah,
you know, you think, oh, that's just a mile away, and it's 5 miles instead of 1 mile, you know?
Yeah, so that was a whole day thing. And we're like, oh, well, blew that stock. And then we got more discouraged because we just kept glassing till dark, or we were going to stay there all evening and see if we could pick up another bear. And then Pilot dropped another camp right on top of us on the beach while we were up there, and these guys were trekking their stuff, and they set a camp up like not very far from our tent, and I was
really
pretty mad. I'm like, no, we're here first.
Which is pretty unfortunate. Yeah, usually it's kind of just a courtesy thing up there.
Yeah.
Fly over, and they circled our tent. They saw our tent was there, and then they landed anyways.
Oh.
So yeah, that's kind of an unfortunate thing when you fly, you know, 2 hours away from the closest town, thinking you're in the middle of nowhere,
right,
and somebody comes and lands on top of you. But it was an old guy. He wasn't
not in the old hunting area, though, right?
I mean, it's all public, but he was guided, and he was an older guy, so they were just going to beach hunt. You know, they weren't going to be going out in the mountains, so we're like, we'll hunt it. But yeah, it was just kind of wild. I mean, we had, like, baby caribou running up to us, and then we glassed a wolf chase a caribou into the ocean, and like, I'm pretty sure it drowned because it never came back.
You
just watch the craziest things, and you're like, oh, there's bears over here, and there's caribou in the ocean over here.
And foxes, when you're sitting there glassing, a fox would come up and sniff your backpack and check you out.
I've seen that a bunch.
Yeah.
That's a normal thing.
Yeah.
Occurrence.
Yeah.
And it would make the same rounds every day. So you just like take in the beauty and majesty of Alaska, and there's volcanoes surrounding, and it's just
super scenic.
Pretty.
Yeah.
Amazing. Very seedlike and cold.
Yeah.
Residents. Yeah.
And I would say probably the next thing.
Day 3 or day 4?
No, it was day 8. It was day 7 or 8. because
by the time we got up there, but when did we first glass it?
We saw him the night before. We saw him the night before, which might have been day 7.
Is it a bigger bear than the first one you'd seen?
We couldn't tell anything. So we see it, and it's somewhere between 5 and 7 miles away in the alpine. And so, I mean, trying to spot something, that far, and you have heat waves and everything, but you can see tracks surprisingly well, especially once the sun hits the snow.
Oh, yeah.
You can see tracks from that far. And then you just see tracks going up to a black dot, and the tracks stop. Mm-hmm. And so it's like, okay, he's laying right there. Kind of our initial plan was, since I was trying to shoot one with a bow, the thought was going to be, let's get one when it's kind of, when they're just waking up out of hibernation, they kind of almost take these really long naps.
Like a little groggy.
Yep. And so that was kind of the plan, try and find one that's just kind of hanging out groggy and then try to get a shot on it with my bow. And so, yeah, that was like, oh, this could be a good bow opportunity. And we both kind of were like, well, we'll just see if that black dot's still up there in the morning, and then we'll make the decision then on if we're going to go up there or not. But the reason I've been thinking that it was day 7 or 8, we can always go back and check, was because Tana was basically like, if we don't kill this bear, we're not going to get one type of deal.
Because you've been out there so long.
Because we've already been out there so long. And there just wasn't many bears out of their dens yet. You know, normally there's bears basically running everywhere from what they made it sound like. And we were seeing maybe one bear a day, you know, and blasting for 18 hours. So
that's a trek.
Yeah, so we spotted that bear the night before. It was like around 5 or 6 p.m. And we watched it till pretty much dark. Like, we put it to bed and it never moved. And we both agreed. We were like, oh, that's far, and is that even worth it going up there? I mean, it's just in the head end of this canyon. And we just both had this agreement, like, well, he's there tomorrow. We'll try. Like, we'll go after it. And so the next morning, we get up bright and early and go up on the knob, and it had not moved. It had been sleeping for 12 hours. So he was still having to go nap.
Yep.
Like, it must have just come out of the den, and they sleep for a while. And
which is weird. It just, it's, yeah, kind of just a funny side point, just again with the amount of animals up there. We were sitting there watching the dot, and there was a group of 4 caribou that were following its tracks up into the alpine. We're like, what are those caribou doing?
Yeah.
And they're following its tracks up into the alpine. It was kind of like this little fog layer was up there.
Like, they couldn't see what
it was. Like, they couldn't see what it was. And they got close, and before you know it, they were all poking straight down the hill. Yeah, I was just like, I do not know what they were doing.
They're not that smart, but when they see a bear, they're like, damn.
Yeah, they know about that.
That's a big red flag.
So, yeah, then we pretty much woke up in the morning. It was still there, and so we're like, okay, well, here we go. Basically with the understanding that we're not going to be able to make it up there and back in a day. I mean, even 18, 20 hours of daylight, it's a long ways up there. There's a lot of river crossings. There's a lot of alders. And, you know, neither one of us had ever even been up that draw before. So you also don't know the exact lay of the land and the best route to take. You know, if you follow the creek up, it was cliffed out on both sides. And so it was have to be above the creek for a ways. And then eventually we probably got halfway, I think, before we were able to get another visual on the bear, which point he actually moved. And so we were a little bit worried about it because he was moving ground pretty fast, actually. We got up on this hill to where, like, okay, let's try to get our bearings and see where he's at. And he was moving it through the alpine really quick. And we were both like, if he goes over that hill, we're never going to see him again.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a hill that you couldn't go up and over. And, he decided to lay down and dig himself another little den and
Take
another nap.
But he's at the top of the mountain this time.
What's the elevation at, like, as you're trekking up?
We're camped at sea level. We were camped pretty much right on the beach. And I think the bear, it was somewhere between 2 and 3. Yeah.
But it was like straight up. I mean, canyon, and then, I was at the top.
Yeah, so you worked your way up the draw. You're not gaining any elevation working your way up the draw. And so you don't gain your elevation until you just start hiking straight up a cliff. I mean, it was almost like sheep hunting cliffs that we were hiking up.
Was it exhausting?
Yeah, and I mean, it's it's called Devil's Club is what this weed's like, and it has spikes pretty much all the way up and down it. And
sounds nice.
Yeah, so like what happens is it's like we were in the
can't see through it too.
Yeah, we were in the spring to where it's the previous year's Devil's Club, but there's still stems that are standing this tall and really pokey, and it's just oceans of them. And so you have to, like, the whole bottom of the hill, you're breaking through this until you get up to where it's just straight rocks or snow.
like the vision in my head's like Mortal Kombat, like you just fall out and pale
yourself. Really not selling me on a laugh. Like smaller
film. I still want to move.
Wow. Yeah, the hike in was
you need like brutal. Trekking poles as you're climbing up?
Yeah, we had trekking poles, and even like stopping along the way on this hike, there was again all these comments Trevor was making, like, oh, we're just gonna go climb up Death Mountain. And not like before we started the climb, once we were at the very bottom, we had, you know, climb 2,500 feet vertical. He's like, Tana, is it really worth dying over a bear?
Like, oh my God.
All these times, though. Yep. Like these premonitions of like, this is a bad idea, you know? And I was like, nope. And then I just started climbing.
Yeah.
And, so as we started climbing, we saw a sow and cubs us and the sleeping bear. And so we kind of waited for them to side hill and move out of the way because we didn't want to run into those.
Yeah, they're never good.
But they're. That's kind of where it opened up, and it was like, we're in the Jurassic Park of bears. Like, there was just, like, bears popping up all over the mountain. One was here, and it was sliding down, and Trevor was almost going to shoot that, but it was a tiny one. And so we let that one go, and then one was over here side-hilling. It was just, like, bears everywhere. We're like, okay, let's just go walk into the middle of all of them with a bow and see what happens.
From nothing to, like, here they are. They're everywhere.
Yeah. Yep.
Quick question.
Step this draw.
When y'all started this trek, did you break camp and take everything with you?
No.
Or just enough to, like, stay overnight?
We brought a tarp and a full dry set of clothes. Clothes, puppies, and rain gear.
Mm-hmm.
In dry bags.
And a tarp.
Yep. Like so just, bag. Yeah, the sleep tarp and then just dry everything, basically. Okay. In dry bags. In Alaska, if everything's not in a dry bag, it will be soaked. Okay. And so if you throw in a pair of rain gear in your backpack and hope that you have dry rain gear, you don't.
Get it.
Yep. So... we didn't really have that much. Honestly, I don't know if we fully thought it all through before we did it. It was just we're just throwing the stuff in.
Yeah,
and we brought enough food for 2 days.
We brought an extra pair of dry socks, which was great. That saved me.
Yeah.
And then you took your bow,
basic rifle.
Bow, the rifle, and the Raging Hunter.
Okay. Nice.
Yep. And so, we were probably halfway up the vertical climb before... I actually had a pair of snowshoes, too, that I threw on, and they're called verts. They're basically just for hiking straight up in snow. And so I luckily had a pair of those, which helped because it almost made, like, stair steps for her. But it was the kind of spring snow that we call it post-holing, where you're just basically, like, you step and you think you're going to float and then shrink down to your knee, you know, and it's which is probably the most exhausting hiking that there is. And so it was just... brutal hiking. We get up to the point we can finally see the bear. It was probably 700 yards, I think, where we could first see it. Just deemed that was too far of a shot. I've shot stuff that far before, but it was just windy and stuff. So we're just like, we need to get closer.
Yeah, you want a good ethical shot.
Yep. And so we got up to about 450, which, to be honest, is usually a pretty easy shot for me. We shoot a lot of long range. We have for 10, 15 years. And so I'm like, 450, this is definitely doable. And like I said, initially we were planning on going with a bow. But to be honest, the day was like starting to come towards the net. Yeah, I mean, it was just like we've been hiking for
5 or 6 p.m.
15 hours.
From the morning. Oh,
yeah. And so it's just, we were just both exhausted. It's like, man, we just need to see if we can get this over with, or, you know, get this bear on the ground and know what we're working with here, what we're doing. And so, I just started shooting at 450. And... I had shot 3 times, and then the rifle jammed. And something I did, which you'll notice in the video if you watch it back, I yelled at the bear because, like I said, he was sleeping. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't have a very good visual on the body, but I also don't have all day to sit here and wait it out and see if he maybe wakes up tomorrow, you know? And,
right.
And so I yelled at him, trying to wake him up.
Hey!
Which, in hindsight, was probably a bad idea, because now he knew where we were at. And so I was trying to get him up. He wouldn't get up, and so I decided to take a shot when he was laying down.
Did you hit it? Oh, he's getting up.
Hmm. still got a couple good shots on him. And so once the rifle jammed, I kept thinking, he's going to die. He's going to die before he gets here. It's just going to die. And so he was just moving so slowly coming down the hill. He had blood, but kind of at us, but he had blood coming out his mouth, blood coming out of his both sides. And he's kind of just slowly working his way down toward us. And it was just, he's going to die before he gets here. And then he started to get pretty close. It started to get to the point where, okay, he's actually getting faster now, you know? And so, which is odd, you would think that, you know, he'd be dying off and getting slower, but it was kind of this combination of him waking up and everything, and he was getting faster and faster. And so I was just like, we need to make more ground between us and to hope that he dies. The initial plan at this point wasn't that we would have to even use the pistol, but it was just, we just need to get more space so that this bear can
all die. While your rifle is still jammed.
All the while, I'm basically panicking, trying to get the rifle unjammed. Can't figure out what it is. I keep putting my finger in there. I mean, just trying to figure out what's jamming. I'd slam the bolt all the way closed, and it would close. But then when you'd go to, you know, fold it over, it wouldn't fold all the way over. And so, you know, you're not going to take a shot like that.
What in the heck is going on?
Did you get a good shot?
I don't know, but I don't know why this thing will not go in. Never seen it do that before. Gosh, dang it.
And so, it was just complete panic. And I, at one point, had pulled out, there was a primer stuck to the bottom of the bolt. So I pulled it out thinking that was it. And so I popped that out, put the bolt back in, closed it. It still was doing the same thing. And so it wasn't that one. We basically just took off running down the hill. I had the Raging Hunter in a gun holster, which it actually fell out when we were running down the hill and lost it in the snow. And that was one of the worst moments for me, where it was like we were probably not even going to have a chance. And then I turned around. And I looked up, and you could see this faint black underneath the snow, kind of right by where Tana was standing, actually, because she was kind of running down the hole behind me. It wasn't even that. It was almost just a, it was almost a black shadow under the snow. I don't even think any of it was sticking out.
How far was it from you? Like, where?
I had to, like, run back up the hill. It was like 10 or 20 yards behind me as Tana was kind of coming down behind me.
Yeah, we're down the hill from the bear, so we can't see it. We don't know where it's at.
Pretty much the second we left our gear, we can't see the bear now.
Oh my gosh.
Because that was a ridge kind of that we worked our way to shoot from.
Quick question. While he's like trying to get the rifle situated, what are you doing? Keeping eyes on the bear?
Yeah, I was ranging. I was like 270.
Yeah, 200 yards. 200, you know, I mean,
Under 200. I mean, he was looking like he was slow, but when you have a 10-foot bear, it's, you know, 12, 13 feet nose to tail. Every stride covers so much distance. And so he looked slow, but like every time I'd range, he's 100 yards closer. And I'm just like starting to panic, like, he's getting close. He's getting close. Come on, Trevor. Like, you got it. But damn it. And then once he started running, like, I knew at that point we were not going to fix the rifle.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, we were just running down the hill. There was one or a couple little rocks basically on this windblown ridge in the Alpine. Just a couple little rocks. You know, about 4 feet tall, roundish rocks that were just sitting on top of this ridge. And so it was, there's one thing to hide behind. Let's go hide behind those rocks, pretty much. So we just book it for those rocks. We both kind of tucked behind the rocks, wondering if the bear was going to know where we were at initially. And he came over the hill, and he knew exactly where we were at.
How far away?
This was probably 150 yards when he comes over the hill. And so he knows,
like, locks eyes exactly where we...
He didn't even follow our tracks. Our tracks went like this, and he just cut off our tracks and came straight to us. And then you're sitting there with a pistol. You know, Tana's sitting there with, I think, holding my bow or something.
Did you put an arrow, knock an arrow on the bow?
No, she didn't, which would have been a good idea. But she's just sitting there holding my bow. And, I'm sitting here. I have to wait.
Yeah.
You know, I can't start shooting. I've got 5 bullets in the gun, and I've got to wait until it's, 25-ish yards before I should start using these, because once I start shooting, I'm not going to have the time to reload. And so I've got these five bullets and then that's it.
Make it count.
Yeah. And so my first shot, actually, he wrapped around one of the rocks and there was a rock in front of him. And in hindsight, I should have just kind of shot for the face, but I kind of was trying to shoot right underneath his chin. And he's running at us with his mouth wide open. I mean, it's hanging wide open and he's huffing as he's running the whole time. So it's a, as like he's coming the whole way down the hill.
We're just watching our life flash before us.
Yeah. And I mean, he's just locked on. I mean, he is coming full bores. Like at this point, it didn't even look like he was wounded.
Nope.
Like, which if you watch the video back, you'll see the shots and you're like, I don't know how it could run that fast. It didn't even look like he was wounded at this point. So I tried to sneak it under his jaw and I actually hit the rock in front of him and it just spattered it in his face, which the bullet still could have hit him, but I mean, probably just pissed him off.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I pretty much like, I don't know, I might have cocked back the hammer. We didn't have this part on film, but I just know in my head, I went, I have to make this count.
Yeah.
And so I think I remember cocking back the hammer and then had one really good hit. And then it just shot my confidence up.
Yeah.
And then I just started firing him off. And so all the rest of them were contact. I had three hits before he turned. And so I had kind of a quartering forward turn at 5 yards where I hit him in the front shoulder.
It was like one lunge.
One lunge from coming over the rock, pretty much. 1 to 2 lunges from coming over the rock. And it was right in the shoulder and it made him whirl. And then when he went to whirl, I put the last bullet just like broadside center mast. And then we pretty much just took off running because the bear kind of disappeared behind this little hill. And I was just like, we have to get uphill.
Yeah.
I just looked at Tana. I was like, we have to get uphill. I don't think this bear can run uphill now, you know? And so it's just try to get as high as we can. But again, there's like these little ridges in the alpine that you can't see stuff. So once we start running uphill, we have no idea where the bear is again. Oh. And it's just... like, it ran that way, but we can't see anything.
He's reloading.
Like, oh, good.
I mean...
that was my...
as we were running. Yeah, yeah.
How hard was that?
It was difficult. It was difficult.
Oh, my God. He did it so fast, I feel like.
It did. I did, but there was honestly... I had a couple-second delay where I've got a couple different revolvers and the double open took me probably 3 extra seconds, and then... I'm like, oh, okay, you know, and I don't know, but I got it reloaded. And at that point, I'm like, okay, we've got 5 more bullets.
Yeah.
Tana, where's the bow? I left the bow down there. And I'm like, well, that would have been, you know, because I was thinking if the bear starts to come back uphill, if it's coming uphill, it'd be going slow enough. I'll start throwing arrows at it, you know.
Go Hunger Games on him.
Yeah, exactly. But luckily it didn't come to that. Then Tana, you kind of say where it went from there.
Up above it. Yeah, so we ran uphill as he was reloading. And that's kind of where I was hitting my wall because, I mean, we just kind of experienced it differently. Trevor, when he was in that fight mode of like, I got to make this happen and save us, you know, he was focused. He had a revolver to save our lives and I had nothing. And that helpless feeling of I can't protect myself was awful. You know, like I saw my life flash. I don't think Trevor did.
Yeah.
I said goodbye to my kids and my husband. I don't think he did because he was focused on like the kill. And I was sitting here just like behind a rock like this is it. I just watched him shoot this with a huge rifle that has killed every animal we've ever shot, you know, over 100 animals and several bears.
What caliber?
338 Ultramag.
Wow.
Yeah. And it's... like nothing, actually.
Right. Yeah. And
we've never shot this at anything before. I'm just thinking, like, we're done.
Yeah.
This is all we have is 5 shots. And so I had already thought, I was like bracing for impact. And when it didn't come over the rock because that last shot turned him, that was where I pulled my phone up and got that last shot on video with my phone because I was supposed to be filming the whole experience. But in hindsight, I was just like, oh my gosh, this is really happening. Like, I'm in a movie. You know, it felt like I was in this movie where this bear is coming at me full speed, but it was real life. And I'm just like, how is this happening? How is this happening? How is this happening? This is how I die. So I had already, like, written off my life. Like, I was ready to go. And then when it was like that bear disappeared and we were still alive and Trevor's reloading, I'm like,
Okay, so he was running full speed uphill, and my adrenaline had already, like, dumped after the run, and my legs were giving out. Like, I was falling, and I was just, like, I couldn't go. My body had already gone past the fight or flight, and it was now in, like, freeze mode, you know? And so Trevor's like, come on, Tana, this is life or death. We gotta go. And I'm just like, I can't move my legs. You know, I was so exhausted, and not even adrenaline could pick my legs up.
Yeah,
somehow I was able to get up to the rock where he was, but I was slow. I mean, I was just, like, trudging through snow up to my quads. You know, I have short legs, a lot shorter than Trevor's. And then once we got to that rock, I was, like, in the fetal position, shaking.
No, that's just... I want to draw a little attention to that. I looked over at Tana, and she's on this grass, like, grassy rock ridge thing, and just laying on the ground. I mean, just like laying flat. Like, can we hide right here? And I was just like, Tana, that's not going to work. You're just like done.
Yeah.
That was it.
So yeah, I pretty much lost all my gas going up that hill. I was just done. Like, my adrenaline had dumped already. We had hardly eaten all that day. And so I think...
You said you missed breakfast. You didn't have breakfast.
Well, last day we had some, but
we had
hiked for like 16 hours straight. And now we ran for our lives. And then we still don't know if the bear is dead. And we're running uphill to try to get up from the bear. So wounded bear up goes slower. And I had remembered a sound that I heard, which was a shh sound when that bear disappeared. And so I thought that he at least slid down or made an avalanche. I didn't know if that meant he was dead. And Trevor was like, you did? And I'm like, yeah, I did. And he was like, I didn't hear that. And so that was probably...
But I was thankful that she heard it. But myself didn't hear it. But I mean, I was like, that's a good sign. That's a good sign that you heard something, or that he was at least up over that hill.
Yeah. And I was just kind of done at that point. I had written off that feeling of I'm going to survive. I legit thought I was going to die. And saw my life flash and everything. And another one of my thoughts, and it was just so weird. The whole charge was so fast. You know, he covered that 150 yards in like 10 seconds. But when you have that 10 seconds intense experience, it's like slow motion. Like, when I look back at it, I feel like it was in slow motion. I thought so many things in that 10 seconds that it felt like it was like slow motion, but like that at the same time.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you experienced
that. I felt like it was the same way for me. Yeah, it just... And... Just another element to throw into it, you know, if you ever try running downhill really fast in the snow, if you get like an extra 5-10 feet on every step when your foot slides, right? Mm-hmm. And so the bear was just able to cover a crazy amount of ground because he's just almost sliding down the hill at the same time. And this hill specifically was quite a bit steeper than everything else that he had to cover to get back to us. And so he covered that last 150 yards. Fast.
Like, bears can run like 40, 45 miles an hour. Like,
yep.
What an apex predator. Like, literally an apex predator. It's like a tank can climb, can smell, quiet. Can see, can be quiet.
Yeah. Yep. A bear that size, you know, it's probably about a 1,000-pound bear that time of year.
Yeah. There's a million things go through your mind. Like, was it going to come after me first? If it comes back, like, am I going to watch my brother die? Like, it was just...
Yeah.
Like, it's usually a joke. Like, it's like, okay, just got to run faster than your homie or untie their shoes.
It's true. Right. Like,
you don't want either of you guys to get eaten.
Well, and in this scenario, I mean, I wasn't married yet. I still don't have any kids, but I didn't have any kids. And so, I was pretty much just like, I'm going to have to take one for the team here. And
you thought that.
Yeah, no, I mean, like, in the milliseconds, like she was saying, that you have these thoughts go through your head. That was one of my thoughts, was she has kids and I don't. So that means I need to be the one to take one for the team.
I love that warrior spirit. No, that's so awesome. Like, what was the train of thought after that? Was like, okay, I'm going to jump on it. I'm going to try to choke it
up. No, I didn't. There was no train of thought. I mean, it was, I have these 5 shots and it's over. You know, after the thought, I was like, you know, bow. Like, I should have had my bow right there to be able to grab an arrow or something and last ditch effort, try and stab it or something in the throat. You know, I don't know. But, we just didn't really have time for that. But like she said, you just, it's like slow motion in the aspect that your mind can run through a million things in that short amount of time. But at the same time, it happens really quickly.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
So y'all make your way back up the mountain. You're above the bear now, but you still don't know where it's at. You've reloaded the pistol.
Yep.
What happens?
We kind of just decided we needed to walk over to our gear, see... And try and just get a visual on where the bear is at and if it's even still alive.
Hey, like, but it took a while. I mean, the dog eated, which way to go?
How long?
We waited probably 30 minutes up there, and it was starting to blow. Like, a storm was coming in. It started to blow 50. It was raining. I was already, like, shaking in shock. Yeah, in shock. Like, we were both really in shock.
Did you cry?
And neither of us. No, I was just, like, in the fetal position shaking, like, yeah, this. And, we just waited up there forever. We prayed a lot, and then we still never saw the bear and didn't know where it come out, so that's what we decided to sidle. But yeah, we waited a good probably 30 minutes in this horrible storm, exposed, you know, up in the alpine, the snow, no thing to, like, get cover behind. It was freezing. I just remember how cold it was.
Yeah. Yeah, and then, again, we're post-holing in snow, so it's wet snow, so everything's soaked. Yeah.
So you've waited it out 30 minutes, the storm's rolling in, you realize you have to move again, and y'all start, do you try and get back to where you shot from, or where you dropped gear initially and ran? Like, what's
where we shot from was where we dropped, where our gear was.
Well, not the,
not, like, no, the charge.
Yeah.
Like, we didn't go back to where it charged.
Okay.
That would, yes, that's what I would guess.
We side-hilled back to our gear.
Okay.
The first rifle shot.
Yeah. Okay. And that's where you had, like, all your stuff to stay overnight, too, right?
Yeah, it was our packs. Yeah. Trevor even had a 360 GoPro on a selfie stick in the snow, and we're like, maybe we got it on video. Because we came all the way around to our gear, and all we saw was bloody bear tracks coming, and he stepped, like, right on our gear. And then that's where, like, we just saw all his tracks in the blood, and it was just kind of surreal. Like, we were
blood all over
looking at it, and
that was a good
call. They brought where the bear was. Yeah. It had legitimately, like, almost stepped on our gear.
Oh, my God.
And his GoPro had died, so we didn't know if we got it on film, which we didn't. It had died, like, just before the bear crossed right there.
Oh, no.
Otherwise, it would have been a one-yard shot of that bear, like, coming at us.
Oh, my God.
But yeah, we were just kind of looking around at our gear, and it took us a minute to even look down the hill and see what we saw.
Well, you kind of had to get to over to the side a little bit. Like, again, there's all these little rolly hills, so you have to kind of try and get around the ridge or be able to see above it. And yeah, I just got to a spot where I could see, and I glassed down there. I'm like, Tana, he's down there. He's dead. And he was down, like, right at the bottom of he basically started a wet avalanche slide. Mm-hmm. Which is usually like the top 6 inches to foot of wet snow. And so there was a big slide that he took down with him basically when he started to slide. And that's what she heard. And he was just laying in the big pile of snow down there.
In your mind, like, is that him? I don't know. I think it took me a minute. I was like, that's not him.
No. We were kind of second guessing.
He's a Terminator.
Are you questioning, is he dead? Is he, like, are we going to have to go through this again? Like, what's going through your mind at that point?
I was pretty sure he was dead. And so I was like, okay, well, he's been in that same spot for the last, 30 minutes or so. That's probably dead. But then when we got all of our gear and went down there, we took a little bit of footage and stuff, which you can even hear in the footage how bad the wind really was.
Yeah.
My brother, that's the editor, was just like, I don't even want to put this in here because you can't hear anything. I'm like, you need to, because that was how it was. It was so windy, like you couldn't even, like, hear yourself think it was so windy, and you're just up in the wide open alpine. And so I started to hike down to the bear. Tana's kind of filming me. And
it's nothing. Trevor's gonna make sure it's dead by walking up to it, poking it, and having a pistol on hand just in case.
Another extra element to add is when you're in alpine in the snow melts around rocks first. Mm-hmm. And so you can have a surface that everything looks like flat snow, but if there's a rock that's poking out somewhere, you're better off to, like, walk way, way, way around it, which I knew of that the whole other time that we were up there. I'm a snowmobiler, snowboarder, and so I have a lot of background kind of in the snow side of things. And so I kind of knew that going up there, but when I was walking down to the bear, what I didn't realize is there was, like, this little rock over to the side in the snow, and I just didn't even see it because I was so focused on, is this bear even dead or alive? And Tana got it on video. I was walking down to it, and what'll happen is where that snow melts around the rocks, it'll basically create, like, these monster caves around the rocks underneath the snow. And I had my whole backpack on and everything, and I just fell all the way down to my shoulders.
Oh.
And I just put my hands out like this and stopped myself. And I mean, so this is like, right, and my feet are dangling. I mean,
right next to the bear.
I was probably 50 yards up from the bear, but my feet are dangling. And I was just like, oh crap. And I was able to like roll out of the hole. And at the time I was like, there wasn't even a rock there. And I watched the video back later. I'm like, there was a rock 10 feet away, but I was just so focused on the bear that I just didn't, I completely missed that element. And then, I was so scared to poke the bear even. I mean, I was getting up there and I was just like, what do I do?
Throw something at it.
Oh, there's four shots.
Yeah, I was about to. I mean, I was about to just shoot it a couple times for good measure, but I only have five bullets left and these need to work on the whole pack out.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, we only had five left. We had five backups.
If any more bear came to you guys, any more bears came through.
Which was very likely.
Yeah.
And now we're covered in blood.
Yeah.
By the time
there's some woody bear there. There's hungry bears coming out of hibernation. There's a sound cubs that just went around the hill. So we had five shots and we were, 8 miles back.
Well, I almost died today. This thing came at us. Trevor ended up shooting it 5 yards away with a pistol while I was hiding behind him because I thought we were going to get attacked. But I had faith in Trevor. I didn't. Oh my gosh, that was insane.
450
meters. I'm so thankful to be alive.
But you think you're out of danger, it's kind of just the beginning.
Yeah,
even getting us into air and like just kind of reliving that. I mean, we walked his whole tracks out to where he had charged us and where he had fell, and we walked to it and we both walked up to it. And usually when we kill something, we're excited. You know, we want to take pictures. We want to do a video. We were both so sick to our stomach. We're like, Trevor's like, I don't even want to take pictures.
I honestly was just like, we don't even need to take a picture. Like, and then Tana's like, we got to take some photos. And so we took like a couple quick photos and that was it.
Like three, maybe.
Yeah.
I hardly took any.
Tana kind of walked around and snapped a couple. And then I set up my camera and I think we took two together And then it's like, let's just get this done. Yeah,
we need to get out of here.
And it was probably, 9, 10 o'clock at this point?
It was like 8, 9 p.m. We had a couple hours of daylight left, but the storm was hitting.
Yeah.
We had 2,500 feet to descend to get to the creek bottom, and that's probably where we were going to sleep. I would have gotten hypothermia and probably not made it.
We couldn't have stayed up in the snow. Yeah.
So we had to get this huge bear, which we found out later was 10 and a half feet, nose to tail, squared out. And get everything off the mountain and down around all the cliff faces that we came up by dark. And we didn't know if that was even possible. And that's when Trevor's shock set in. I had already kind of been through my shock and I was in work mode. I got to get this thing skinned out and get off this mountain. And Trevor just went and sat.
No, I had to get something to eat because, again, we hadn't eaten much. And I was able to eat right at that moment, but it was just force feeding myself kind of. Just with, it was just like, my body needs fuel. Like I hit a wall where it's just like I honestly can't move unless I eat something. Yeah. Right. And I just hit that wall. And so it was actually when we were skinning it up. So Tana did a pretty major portion of skinning the bear because I just had to make a quick freeze-dried meal. I don't even think I ate very much of it, but I just had to get a couple bites down. And then, we threw it on backpacks. Tana ended up taking, I think, the skull. And I took the hide, which we later weighed. The hide was 108 pounds dry, and so that's not including my backpack, my gear, wet, any of that stuff. And then Tana, she took a fairly good portion of my gear even because I had to hide. So Tana was over 100-pound pack. I was in the ballpark of 150. We started to head down the mountain.
How long that took?
That took hours. I mean, it was because, again, we were working through cliff lines, and I had my track set on my phone, but it's really hard to tell specifics, and especially when it's like there was this one little window between the cliffs, and you get down there, and it's getting dark, you know, it's probably, it was.
Yeah, we descended.
It was like 11:30 when we were about halfway down the hill when we got out of the snow and kind of going down through the cliff lines. And yeah, it was just an absolute downpour.
Going through thick brush in the dark, covered in blood with bears in five shots. We're like, was like, hey, bear. Like, I was just trying to be so loud.
Yeah.
Most of them, you know, that are hunted, they're scared of people, you know. Obviously, this one came at us because he had heard us, and once you piss them off, they'll come. But if they hear you, they're not going to come to you.
Yeah.
Because they get hunted, so. Yeah, so we're trying to get down the hill to the gravel bar so we can try to sleep for the night. And I'm just trying to be loud and scare bears. I think I was playing music on my phone just because I was so freaked out. I just had to distract myself.
You were.
So I was, like, just playing music.
As loud as you can.
Yeah, it's not very loud with that breeze of wind and stuff, but I'm just like, I'm trying to make it. We're not gonna
flashlights all over the place.
You were just, at that point, you're having like these flashbacks every 10 seconds of the trash, you know?
Yeah, and there, to be honest, there wasn't a whole lot of conversation either. We got to the bottom. We set up the tarp in the riverbed just because it was really the only thing that wasn't brushy down low. And so we don't have sleeping pads or anything, you know, we're sleeping on, you know, 4-inch round river rock, basically, with no pads, no pillow. They were all soaking wet to start off with. I mean, by the end of the night, the little tarped off area that we had, at least the rocks kind of dried off there. But we got under our tarp, got all of our dry clothes on, our dry puffies, and then a layer of, I think Tana did too, a whole dry layer of rain gear also.
Okay.
And so dry puppies, dry rain gear, dry socks, and then
still
cold though, but just bundle up, you know, and I was able to lay there on the rocks and fall asleep just because I was so exhausted. I slept for probably 2 hours. I woke up at about, I don't know, it was probably 3 or 4 in the morning, whenever it just started to get light, and I don't think we went to sleep, or I didn't, until about 1, and Tana was in the fetal position just on the rocks like this. And I'm just like, did you even sleep? And she's like, nope. And I was just like, okay, well. And then I'm like, well, I have, I think it was 5 to 6 miles as the crow flies, but probably more like 8 miles for the hike out, with all the zigzagging and river crossings and everything like that.
To get back to the beach.
To get back to where our tent is.
Okay.
Yeah. And also where we could be picked up.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I knew that we were going to have to do that trek, and so I was like, I'm going to eat some food. And so I have never force-fed myself like that before, but again, we were both just so sick to our stomach. I mean, we hadn't even really talked. I mean, we were still like almost just silent through the night and most of the hike down. I mean, we just didn't really say a whole lot. Tana, I think, tried to cook something, and she was just like, I can't eat this, and throws it.
You just, like, when you have that amount of adrenaline, you cannot force feed your everything that goes in your mouth, your body tries to throw it up.
I did.
Because
it
focuses
every
survival. And Trevor was just, like, gagging it down, and I'm like, I just can't. I'm just going to go all day with no food.
Again. I was seriously gagging it down. Like, I'd gag probably 2-3 times before I could swallow. And then it was just like, I know that I need this to go out 8 miles with a 150-pound pack.
Yeah, there's
like,
no way.
There's no way I can
you
do that.
Eat any, I just burn muscle, yeah.
She didn't eat anything. I mean, she did that whole 8-mile hike out without food that day.
Oh,
zero food that day. No food, no sleep. She didn't sleep.
Wow. Anymore. And I hadn't had any food since the bear charge either. Yeah.
What a snack. Yeah.
No, I was just
unbelievable.
Yeah.
But when we were under that tarp, you know, I had communications with my husband Adam back home.
Oh, good.
And he was with our kids, and we have an inReach, and so you can message through that inReach. It's like a GPS, and it'll give your coordinates. It has an SOS button. There was no SOS. Like, I just kept thinking, if something would have happened or if we were seriously injured, would we have survived? No. And my worry was, even though we got to that tarp, I still was like, hey, I'm not survived unless I'm back to the tent, because I don't even know if I'll make it through the night. I might get hypothermia. Like, I was so cold, I couldn't sleep.
Yeah.
And I was just convulsing all night long. And so I just had to watch, like, keep my body temperature good enough. But yeah, it was just exhausting. So I was messaging Adam to see when he could pick us up. And he's like, that storm is just not going to let up for a while. You're just going to have to survive it. And then I looked back at our messages, because I had messaged him before Trevor even made the very first shot on the bear with a rifle. And I can't remember even what I said. Or maybe, no, it was after the first or second shot. And I said, the gun's jammed. And, like, that's all I said because I didn't know if he knew anything that I didn't about the gun and, like, how to unjam a rifle. We just couldn't figure it out. Was it hot? Was it frozen? What was going on? And then I had messaged him when we knew the bear was dead. And from the time that we shot the bear to the time we knew it was dead with those messages was a 45-minute time lapse. And it didn't feel like that, you know? So we were running for our lives and surviving that 45 minutes before we even knew the bear was dead, which in my head, I thought it was maybe 15. You know, it didn't feel like it was very long. We were like, that was almost an hour of us, like, running from the thing. Not
running for your life.
Yeah. Yeah. So then I messaged him again on the bar or the rock sandbar down there. And yeah, he was pretty shooken up. He's like, "You guys okay? Do you know, what do you need me to do?" And but he couldn't come. Like, he could not come because of the weather.
It's too bad.
There's nothing you can do at that point. So we just had to survive the next 24 hours, and that's what we did.
Even if one of us would to have got partially mauled by a bear, a helicopter could not have came in that weather. I mean, even if you push the SOS button, nobody could have came for over a day.
Yeah. Which is why it's good to know first aid and all the things and be trained on all this stuff, because nobody can save you when you get in those positions. So
what was the message you sent to Adam? Did you tell him, like, "Hey, we almost died, bear charged us," like, or did you
it was
keep
pretty
that
minimal,
until
but
you,
there was
he could see you? Or
I think I said, like, "A bear charged us, we almost died, Trevor shot it,
bring the plane."
I think it was pretty minimal. I don't even remember.
Yeah.
And it was like almost more story later. It was just there was too much to say. I mean, I think Adam had sent that message to our parents and just family, basically. But again, they were kind of just concerned because they didn't have any more details than that either. They're like, "Wait, what? What, you know, what's going on?"
I think he didn't even know if we survived at that point. I was like, "We lived, but..." Then he was sending me messages like, "Are you alive? Is everything okay? Is the bear dead?" And we're like, "I don't know." You know, so imagine being the husband on the other end that, like, there's a bear, like, out there trying to get my wife, and I don't even know if it's dead.
I can't do it.
You know? Yeah. He couldn't do anything about it, so I think he felt pretty helpless.
Yeah. So how long did y'all have to wait for him to be able to fly in and get you?
Well, so that we had the pack out was, like, 8 miles, it took all day. It was pretty much in a monsoon the entire time. I mean, just like, I don't know what your guys' rains are like here, but in Idaho we don't get rains like that. I mean, we can have heavy rain, but it's Alaska, it's like a different type of heavy rain. It's like, where it's just like so much moisture. And so, I mean, we're soaked through our what was dry rain gear at the beginning of the day. And I think we got back to the tent. Well, it was probably about 5 o'clock at night, wouldn't you say, that we got back to the tent? And then it just started to clear off. And I was to the point before the tent that I would collapse after about 150 yards. And then I'd just have to stop and let my legs get enough of a break that I could stand up again and go another 150 yards.
Yeah, we couldn't make it very far. We'd like put the packs on, go a little ways, and just have to rest.
It was weird doing, I mean, we probably had 10 river crossings that day.
Oh.
Because the river crosses and goes to a cliff on one side, then crosses and goes to a cliff on the other side. And so you just have to cross the same river like 20 times. You can't go around it or else you're cliff climbing. And so, it was definitely a process. But then I think you just messaged Adam and we're just like, well, we're here now. And so that was kind of the safety zone is we've got this tent with cots in it. Which is like, this is a win. We slept on gravel bar last night. And so, I mean, I don't know. I probably slept for 12 hours. I mean, laid down and fell asleep.
We were finally able to rest.
Okay. Yeah. Did you talk to the old guy who set up camp next to y'all and say, "We just got attacked by a bear," or were they even
there? We saw them on the beach, I think. Yeah, right before we got back to our tent, we saw them and we kind of told them the story and they were just like, wow.
I think they were just both looking at us like, "Did you just do that? Like, where did you go? Were you like all the way up there?"
We pointed to him, and they were both like, even the guide was just like, "What? You went where?"
"You did what?
Wow.
We're going to sleep now. Bye."
And they almost kind of looked mad, like we got a bear and they did it or something.
But it was spot you couldn't even see a bear. I mean, it's just like there's all these huge mountains and it was just all the way up this draw, you know? So it was just like, most of the other spots you couldn't even see that far.
Oh my gosh.
And
But they weren't like, "Wow, you survived that." It was like, "Oh, cool.
Congrats. It was so weird. They were really weird.
That's really awkward.
I don't like them at all.
Yeah.
I don't think
they ever got a bear.
Yeah. No, I don't think they did either. And then Adam, it was just the next day. Adam and his buddy came in and swooped
us up. What was the level of excitement to see that plane come in?
It was just huge relief.
Yeah. And normally,
he actually survived.
Adam's about business. So normally when he comes to camp, you want to have all your stuff packed and ready to go at the strip.
Yeah.
And or else you're going to get your ass chewed. and so normally, I mean, it's just like we have to have everything there. And this trip, I mean, we just didn't. I don't even know if we had the tent put up yet. I mean,
you're so exhausted.
And we just, he just did not, he just let us.
Did we do all
he came
this?
And helped us.
Pop a bear, just
carry it back to camp. Yeah, it was a process, but he didn't yell at us that time.
It's never like shuttling your gear away.
It was probably like a quarter to a half mile of shuttling gear from like where we camped, like ended. Down around the beach. And that was a little bit of a process too. But about a 2-hour flight home, and then we were home free.
What caliber did you guys use on the bear?
So we started with the .338 Ultra Mag and the rifle, and then the .454 Casull was what did the magic.
Okay. We took it down.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
And the next day, my husband bought me another one.
Rightfully so.
Yeah. We need one too. We each need to have a backup on us at all times. No matter how many rifles you have, everyone needs a backup on their chest at all times.
Always.
Yeah.
And just another side note I'd like to say is a lot of people after that were like, why didn't you pack 10 millimeters? You could have had 15 rounds if you packed a 10 millimeter, all that type of stuff. And after a gun failure like that, a rifle failure, you rarely have rifle failures.
Yeah.
Bolt action rifle failures.
Right. I mean, that is a very rare thing to have happen. Mm-hmm. And basically what we came up with was it was the elements. It was starting to pop primers, it was a load that we have been using for 10 plus years, killed hundreds of animals in all sorts of different snow and different environments, and it never popped one primer, and it popped two.
And one of the primers fell at the perfect angle down in the action screw to prevent the bolt from closing. It was just this perfect storm. How did it fall just like that? And just this freak accident.
Yeah. So with that, that was kind of a testament to me. If you're in these conditions, a revolver could be your saving grace. Yeah. If we had a 10 millimeter, there's just as good of a chance that jammed on the second shot and you just die. Yeah. We could have died.
More reciprocating parts.
Right. And you can still have, just even the cream of the crop. And when you put those kind of hard elements, we started out the day in soaking rain, and then we go up in the Alpine and it's snowing on us and freezing.
Blizzard.
And so it was just like the combination of those elements is really hard on stuff. Yeah. And you can have a perfect working system that you throw in that and it doesn't work right.
Yeah. Yeah. And in a true emergency, you don't have time for 15 shots.
Yeah. Yeah. And so really, revolver. Yeah. Revolver is pretty much foolproof,
So y'all get back home. You're safe. You can finally let your guard down. Did you deal with any, I don't even know what the right word would be, any trauma of any kind of what you went through, once you were back home and able, your brain could fully replay what happened? Was there any aftermath?
Yeah, so the aftermath for me was pretty rough. It took me probably a year to work through it and not be terrified to get in the woods again. Though I did go out on a solo caribou hunt just a couple months after, but I didn't see any bears there, and I think I was still kind of on the shock porch. We're like, oh, I'm good, I'm fine, nothing bad's gonna happen. So I did a solo caribou hunt, and then I went on a moose hunt and got a moose with my bow, and I felt like I was kind of getting better. And then I went out and I actually saw a bear, it was Adam's bear hunt actually. Mm-hmm. And I went on that bear hunt with him, and it just totally wrecked me. It was like, why did I go out bear hunting 6 months after this experience? And after seeing that bear, it was close to him, 50 yards, and it just wrecked me. I was having extreme anxiety and flashbacks again and stuff. So it took me another 6 months of therapy to work through that experience and kind of heal my nervous system after that, because it was just so intense. And I think the biggest thing for me was
it would have been different. What I determined is it would have been different if I had a gun on me.
Yeah.
And I could have protected myself. But the fact that I felt so helpless, that's what destroyed me with this and had so much trauma behind it. And so I was just getting better this last summer. It was a year after the charge, and I started running these retreats, and we saw tons of bears all summer. I wasn't fazed. I mean, I'd still get a little bit of, like, butterflies and nervousness in my chest, but not like before. Like, I had worked through a lot in therapy. And then I went out on a moose hunt with my friend, and I brought her up from Montana, and I was kind of her guide as a friend, just to help her get her moose first. She was for a shooter. And literally the first 30 minutes of opening day, we run into a moose, and the moose came at us. And my friend had the same revolver that saved our lives on that bear, and she had never shot it before. She just had it as a backup, and I had my gun, which was the little bit longer barrel, but it's still the 454 Casull. It's the 6-inch, not the 5. And both of us had the Raging Hunter draw at this moose, and I threw a warning shot at him, and he just put his head and came down.
Oh.
I mean, we tried to get away from him, and he ended up, like, following us 100 yards, and then we were in the middle of nowhere. We couldn't cross this creek, and he had us pinned, and he was either going to kill us or breed us. I don't know which.
It's like, but neither were good.
Yeah.
So not a win-win there.
We the rut.
And, he gained an opportunity, too. Like, you were, disengaging, everything.
We got upwind. He had smelled us. I yelled at him. He followed us. Even though he was downwind, coming right into our wind.
Oh, gosh.
We got another 100 yards distance, and then he just came faster. I gave him a warning shot through his horns, thinking that would scare him, and then he just came harder. And so my friend, I think, missed, but I just told her, wait, and she kept trying to shoot when he was, 50 yards. But, you know, moose are big. At 50 yards, they look close, and I was like, wait, wait, wait. And I killed that thing. I dropped it. Took 3 shots. I didn't use all 5. But boom, boom, boom. He was going right after my friend first, and so I she had a baby at home, and that was kind of my thought, is like, I can't let this thing stomp my friend to death, you know? And so 3 shots, the 3rd one was in the spine to drop it, and that was just so different. I mean, I had had that complete opposite experience, like being the Trevor of, I'm the protector, I'm the one that's going to do it. I did not feel fazed by that in the moment. You know, I felt confident, I felt, I've got this. I didn't see my life flash. I didn't feel near death, even though a huge giant moose was coming at us. So, that gun has saved my life twice now, 2 years.
Oh, God.
And,
what are the chances of a person having one near-death experience like y'all went through, but then a year later to have another situation?
Get
like
charged,
that?
I think Ken is asking for it at some point.
They have 9 lives.
Oh, yeah.
Word is going to spread through the Alaskan frontier. Yeah. Do not mess with this woman.
No.
Yeah, that all stuck out. Who found it out?
Do you feel like that helped you heal even more after that moose encounter?
It did, but it almost brought back some of the trauma of everything's out to kill me.
Yeah.
You know? Every time I see a moose or bear or anything, like I even saw one in my yard last year when I was walking around, and I just panicked, you know, because your body remembers, your body can score. And so it's like, I just want to get to the point where I can be in the woods and not be afraid of everything.
Yeah.
You think it's a once-in-a-lifetime thing. Like, oh, bear's going to charge you? Yeah, that's not going to happen to everyone. And that's a one-and-done thing. And then, a moose charges me the next year. So I'm like, how common is this? What am I doing wrong here? But I think just being prepared is the biggest thing. And trust my life with that gun, and I tell everybody that. So
that is, the best testimony for this right here that we could have ever hoped for. And to be honest, these guns were designed for that type of self-defense situation, for backcountry hunters or, you know, people out bear hunting. That's what these are for.
Mm-hmm.
And y'all have literally put them to the test and lived to tell the story. I mean, y'all need to go buy a lottery ticket. I'm going to buy a lottery ticket with you.
Yeah.
It's incredible. I'm just in shock of, one, surviving a bear attack, but then everything else, all the elements you were exposed to, what you had to survive outside of just the bear attack alone.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
The pure will to survive,
Yeah.
The fatigue that you went through, both physically, mentally, spiritually, That's a story, man. Like I said, this needs to be like on Lifetime.
Yeah, this needs to be a movie. Y'all need to go talk to some producers.
Somebody else. Oh, gosh. This is insane. Wow. Ugh. So maybe we shouldn't hunt with them because we might get charged too.
I'll hunt with her. She's two for two.
She can protect us.
Yeah.
y'all to protect us.
Good luck.
That is true.
She better not hand it off that time.
Well,
she had her take it the next time.
I'm going to have like six holsters with Raging Hunter, some bandoliers with ammo.
Extra ammo. Oh, my gosh.
Man, I'm up for another bear tag this year. I'm like, do I need to go?
Yes, you do.
How do you feel about it?
Is that going to heal me?
Maybe we'll film that one.
Yeah, let's go. I got five backups.
There you go. We'll be there. Be on a tripod. Tana, that one.
I see a bear I'm shooting. I don't care which one.
Looked at you wrong. I hate him.
6 points. Let's go.
Yeah.
So awesome. Are you going to go on that hunt?
Yeah.
I think I'll go again.
Yeah.
After that hunt, I was like, I'm never bear hunting again. I told my husband on the flight, like, don't ever let me bear hunt again. And then I went six later. Yeah. It's just to help him and film in. And I'm like, never again. I'll do it again. What about you?
I'd do it again.
Yeah.
I would. Yeah. There's a lot of things that I would do differently if I did it again. I'd say having the high ground is an important aspect when you're hunting bears.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They're the bears of that stature. I mean, I wouldn't do something like that for a black bear or something like that. But a bear like that, I mean, he soaked up somewhere between 7 and 9 bullets before he turned, and big caliber, bullets. And so to me, it's just a testament. You want to be above it.
Yeah.
You want to be above it. I don't think if we were above it shooting at 450 yards, I don't think it would have been able to come up 450 yards. But
and you don't want him to know where you're at.
Yeah. Also,
don't scream at.
Also, another key element. Don't yell.
don't yell.
No, it's Champ.
It's coming.
Just the whole family.
Well, you guys narrated the story perfectly. Like I felt like I was there. Like I felt like I was there on the mountainside with you guys.
I was sweating.
A roller coaster ride. Armpits sweaty. My hair.
And sweaty.
I was crying, man.
Like, I truly felt like we were reliving this moment with you guys. And I'm going to go back to that spot.
Yeah.
I'm going to go another bear, and I'm going to go there. Yeah, I'm just going to have my moment on that mountain.
Meditate.
Just going to kill every bear in sight.
Yeah.
I surprised this. I just felt pretty stupid after that experience that we got ourselves in that situation. We made a lot of mistakes. We didn't pay attention to our intuition and our gut and like feeling like it was wrong. We went after it anyway, just to kill the bear, you know, it was the mission, accomplish the mission. We're very driven and oriented and mission driven. So it was just get the mission done. But looking back, like it's changed the way that I hunt. It's changed the way that I stalk animals now. And I can like turn away if I feel like it's
you're able to educate other hunters after that experience. It's not like it just dies with you because you stopped hunting. You're actually helping other women. Yeah. You know, understand what's going on in the wilderness because there's so many different variables that can change at any time, you know, so that
is prepared for it. It's important and trained.
Yep.
The will to survive. Yeah. Pretty amazing.
I think a lot of it, even, you know, regardless I don't know. It's just a lot of it has to do with how much, like, even if you don't practice a lot, it's just how comfortable you are because in that instance, you're not thinking.
Yeah.
Like for me, I wasn't thinking really that much. It almost just my body took over. Yeah. Especially like I said, after I cocked the hammer back and got once I connected one time, my body just took over. Yeah. You know, and it's like her video where she scans over to me, I don't even look that stressed out. You know what I mean? I'm just
you're in the zone.
Yeah, I was just kind of in the zone, but it was again, my body just took over. I wasn't thinking through that whole process. I wasn't necessarily thinking about every shot that I was taking. It was just almost just instinct. And so if
autonomous.
Right. So, I mean, you kind of want to be comfortable with whatever you have to where your instinct can take over if you were going to freeze in a situation like that. You know, if you were going to freeze, you wouldn't make it. So.
Oh, my gosh. There you have it. Taurus saves lives.
That's right. Raging Hunter. Twice. Yeah. Guys, thank you all so much for being here, for sharing this story. it was an incredible experience for us to sit here and listen to this firsthand. But we truly appreciate y'all being here today and sharing this with us and being our video guinea pigs for our first video podcast.
Yeah. All the way from Alaska and Idaho, we greatly appreciate your time, and just having you out here is huge. Like, so awesome. Thank you for sharing that experience with us.
Thank you for having us. Yeah, it was fun.
And for those of you watching, we appreciate you checking in and being a part of our first video podcast. If you were listening, head over to TarsUSA.com where you can find the video link. If you're into listening only, then make sure you subscribe to the page. That way you don't miss when new episodes drop. We're on Apple, Spotify, Amazon, and Google. And as always, we want to hear from you. If you have comments, suggestions, or people that you want to hear from, we're always looking to have people on the show with us that y'all are interested in and hearing about. So email us at podcast@tarsusa.com. And until next month, we'll talk to you then.
The Taurus by the Horns podcast. By the Horns.